Imagine a world without death or disease, where the human body could be serviced and repaired like a machine, and new parts built from scratch. A world of artificial organs and bionic implants. A world of cyborgs. At the moment, this is still the stuff of science fiction, but it could be the future of medicine, and sooner than we realize. We are witnessing a revolution in medical science, dramatic breakthroughs, new techniques to enhance the human body. And at the vanguard of this revolution are medical mavericks, people willing to be implanted, modified, and rewired. People willing to transform their bodies in the name of experimentation and blaze the trail towards a new cyborg future. In the hills of Southern California, bizarre plans are being hatched.
It would be beaut to make the ear pretty much like my actual ear, but also to sort of individualize it instead of just using a...
An Australian performance artist known as Stellark wants to become a cyborg.
Well, we were talking about...
And he's persuading two of America's leading plastic surgeons to help him.
One's facing in, one's facing out.
Stellark wants them to fit him with a prosthetic, artificial ear.
Originally, it was going to be like this.
Not as a replacement, but as an addition.
A little bit high. And also, I thought...
A third ear, to supplement his two natural ones.
We had a discussion by email.
And this new ear will be located on his forearm.
Yes.
Now, would you want it here or over the radius?
Stellark wants the ear to be able to pick up sounds and then transmit them via a Bluetooth connection to the internet.
I would think the best way to do it would be to implant a microphone, somewhere near the ear, out of sight. If you can then, we were thinking of getting maybe a 20 French chest tube.
Yes.
Okay, then we could then send that tube up your arm to a receiver, a transducer that could then send the signal to a computer, or it could just be to a PA system where the sound can then come out. Yeah. And that would be...
Or in effects... see it as interface to a mobile phone.
Right.
Yeah.
That could be the auditory capacity of the ear, if you will.
For three decades, Stellark has been exploring the limits of the human body in the name of art. He is best known for the series of suspensions he's performed throughout the world. His naked body pierced by steel hooks and hung up in a variety of different ways.
The idea in the suspension events of positioning the body in space, not simply grounded. This generated a series of images which I think were strange and startling. I've never really been interested merely in the surface appearance of the body, but the mechanics of the body, how the body is engineering.
Stellark's recent work has been about altering the body's engineering, trying to become a cyborg. He's built a series of prosthetic devices designed to extend the body's capabilities. But he's always wanted a prosthesis that would be a part of him, not attached to his body, but built into it. So he dreamt up the idea of an extra ear. He had hoped to graft a new ear onto his face, but doctors were worried this might damage important nerves. So Stellark changed tack. He decided to move the ear to his left forearm.
Inevitably, there are going to be associations to other ears in art history. But instead of someone cutting off his ear, like Van Gogh, here there's an artist that wants to construct an additional ear. And in this case, too, not as a prosthetic replacement, but rather as an aesthetic addition.
The idea of the cyborg dates back to the early days of the space program. NASA scientists wondered, could they engineer a new type of human, one specially designed for the demands of space travel. With machine parts to control heart rate, metabolism, even breathing. And they coined a new term to describe such a super astronaut. Cyborg.
A cyborg is a cybernetic organism. Take the two words, jam them together. Basically, it's a mixing of organic, animal, human material, and machine. The idea is that we integrate with the machine, so the machine becomes like our body and it takes care of us without us having to think about it.
The revolution in transistorization makes machines much, much smaller in the 1960s. It really wasn't possible to think about implanting machines, small machines, into the body until that kind of technological advance had happened. Technology begins to invade the body itself.
In reality, the space-traveling cyborg never caught on. But the idea of the man-machine has been with us ever since. Not out in space, but here on Earth. Cyborgs are everywhere among us today. Anyone with a hip replacement, a pacemaker, even contact lenses, is strictly a cyborg. Their body functions with the help of artificial technology. But the cyborg vision is of technology being used not just to fix us, but improve us.
There is this sense of enhancing and moving beyond the capacities of the average human. It's that dream that drives the cyborg culture.
And this is what Stellark wants to do. To find out what a human body would be like with an extra ear. He has spent 9 years looking for doctors willing to take on this project.
When we see the bleeders...
He has found them in Mal Lesavoy from Los Angeles and Sean Biddick of UT Dallas. Two plastic surgeons intrigued by the artistic and medical challenges of such unusual surgery. This first procedure is to create a pocket for the new ear. To do this, they're using a tissue expander, a concertina-shaped plastic bag.
We'll just have the tubing come like so, you know, all the way.
The expander will sit in Stellark's arm for the next 2 months, and gradually it'll be inflated with saline solution.
Maybe, Sean, you can, with your finger, kind of smooth, see if you can.
The plan is to stretch the skin on the forearm without cutting off blood supply. The process of turning Stellark into a cyborg has well and truly begun.
Super. It's good size. Good choice.
Stellark has a long history of exploring ways to expand the functionality of the human body. But this is just the first step. We are now players in the evolutionary process of Stellark.
Melbourne, Australia. Home to renowned performance artist Stellark. For 30 years, he has been exploring the limits of the human body. But now he wants to become a cyborg. He's going to fit an artificial ear onto his forearm. His team of American plastic surgeons have placed a tissue expander under the skin of his arm. Stellark needs to fill it with saline solution. His video diary records the process.
I can actually feel the pressure in the expander now quite considerably.
Over several weeks, Stellark injects himself every few days. As the expander gets larger, the skin around it is meant to stretch. But no one has ever done anything quite like this before. And it's unclear how the arm will cope with the saline overload.
It's really ballooned up, hasn't it? The skin's turning white. Look at that. What if that's supposed to happen?
When I would do an injection, the skin would sort of turn white. I would need to massage it and, you know, 10 to 15 seconds later, it would resume its normal skin color. But I guess in retrospect, this was, you know, an early alert warning signal that maybe we were pushing this a little too fast.
Time for Stellar to return to the States, to Los Angeles, and his team of plastic surgeons.
If we do have to construct the ear in this position,
The tissue expander has not worked as they had all hoped. The skin has turned black and died.
Well, it still can be used because it can be shifted.
The surgeons will have to work with another area of the forearm to make the pocket for Stellark's ear. But there's a problem. The skin here is not as thin or elastic as they would like.
Correct. So in other words, you'll be able to pull up this
all the
tissue.
Time we're dealt with situations where we have to kind of fix things on the fly,
yeah.
And use our imagination and creativity,
yes.
To specifically deal with the problem,
yeah.
And
yeah.
That's what we're going to have to, yeah. Do today.
This willingness to improvise is typical of cyborg science. Any new implant involves experimentation. People willing to take risks with their body. People like Ken Whiteman, the man with the bionic eye. Ken was born and bred in Lancashire, England. He has always led an active, healthy life. But on the eve of his retirement, he had an accident with caustic soda and lost both his eyes.
When I was in casualty, the nurse was holding her fingers up. I could just see them vaguely. And that's the last thing I've ever seen was her four fingers. I never saw anything after that. Absolutely nothing. What I really miss are the simple things in life, like walking in the country and seeing the trees, the flowers, the birds. Simple things like that.
Now, remarkably, yes. Ken has regained some sort of vision.
Some object somewhere in about approximately that range.
Two electrodes have been fitted within the visual cortex of his brain.
And now it's ended again.
They are capable of blasting pinpricks of light, phosphenes, onto his field of view.
Marvellous feeling to actually see something, although in a sense you're not seeing anything, you're just seeing phosphenes, but you were seeing something instead of just complete blankness. The whole thing starts with the pinhole camera on the glasses here that has a circuit board that converts the light wave to electric waves, and the electric waves go down to the computer, and the computer passes the information to the stimulator here that will then send it up the wires to these two percutaneous pedestals each side of the head that are screwed to the skull. And each one then has 72 wires going up to the visual cortex on the brain. And so as you're scanning around like that, then you're getting different phosphenes lighting up. There they are, they're starting to light there, on the edge of something. Lighting. And then it's ended again. So whatever it is roughly from there to about there. Might be a slim chunk of a tree or something. See? Quite a lot up there. If that is a tree there, I might be looking at the branches, in which case I'd be seeing them everywhere, which is what I am doing. Hopefully it will lead to better and bigger things. Who knows? Everything's got to start somewhere, and this is where this started.
Only 16 people in the world have so far been fitted with a bionic eye. It's still very much an experimental system, but researchers are hoping that as technology improves, bionic eyes will become as common as bionic ears. 20 years ago, the idea of using electronic implants to overcome deafness was considered radical, speculative science. Now it is well established, a routine surgical procedure.
There you go, so we'll stop there for a moment. Let's...
Having drilled a hole through the patient's skull, the surgeon has access to the cochlea, the inner ear.
Now this here is the cochlea, a rather whitish structure there.
A tiny array of electrodes can now be inserted into the cochlea. It'll stimulate the auditory nerve and send audio signals directly to the patient's cerebral cortex.
You're talking to the brain through this system, directly to the brain, without the participation of the ear in any way, which is remarkable. There it goes, slips into place.
The electronics for the implant sit near the surface, embedded into the skull. The system is now complete. The patient has become a cyborg. Michael Karas has a cochlear implant. He's a writer who was born severely deaf, and then, 5 years ago, lost his hearing completely.
Am I a cyborg? Technically, yes, because I have a computer in my body that controls my hearing. But I don't like to use the word in saying, I am a cyborg. It's kind of like saying, I am a Mercedes because I drive a Mercedes, which I don't, by the way. And you can certainly say that I have a cyborg body, but I would not say that I am a cyborg. I am Mike. I am a writer, a person, a human being.
Around the world, 100,000 people have now been fitted with cochlear implants.
What's that?
A drum.
A drum.
Young children are often hearing sounds for the first time.
She's doing really well.
The key is the system software. It controls the exact volume, frequency, and range of audio signals that the patient receives.
Yeah.
Everything sounds different when I get new software. Because I'm getting information that I have not gotten before, my brain has to learn how to use it. So sometimes things sound squeaky, or fuzzy, or too loud, or too soft. The scientists can't hear the devices. They don't know what it sounds like. The patients do. So there is a symbiotic relationship between the patients and the scientists. I've said before that if a Nobel Prize is ever given to cochlear implant researchers, one of the patients should be included in that award.
You got it?
Got it.
So this is a little...
Compared to a cochlear implant or a bionic eye, Stellarc's artificial ear is technically a much simpler proposition. There are no electronics or computers, but it's still a big deal to create something that'll look and function like a real human ear.
Seated position.
Any body modification or augmentation is fascinating because it goes beyond the biological status quo.
It looks pretty good.
And that's the ear right there.
There's something kind of intriguing about replicating and repositioning a bodily feature.
Transmitter to connect it to a microphone, which goes down the sterile Foley catheter, and you can see the tip through the holes. One, two, three, four.
After
five.
9 years of trying and hoping that I could raise funds getting surgical assistance, all of a sudden it was happening.
The future of medicine, according to science fiction, will be a future of cyborgs. Human bodies made up of artificial parts, which can be replaced and upgraded whenever necessary. Already, this fictional future is starting to become a reality. Computer implants are widely used to overcome deafness. An electronic eye has been developed to help blind people. And now, the most vital organ of all is becoming bionic. In the United States, 250,000 people a year die from cardiac disease. Many could have been saved by a transplant, but healthy donor hearts are hard to find. Doctors in Germany are trying a radically different approach. Instead of transplanting human hearts, they're pioneering the use of artificial ones. Dieter Marcinczyk is close to death. His heart is so badly diseased it needs to be replaced within hours or he'll die. But doctors don't have a donor heart to give him. Instead, he is one of the first people in the world to be offered a bionic heart. It's Dieter's last chance.
What do you feel about the fact that you're going to be given an artificial heart?
Well, there's no other option for me. What can I say? It's either sink or swim.
If all goes to plan, in less than 5 hours, Dieter's life will be transformed. he'll be completely dependent on his new mechanical heart. To get access to Dieter's heart, the surgeons crack open the rib cage. It's now clear how diseased the organ really is.
This is the right ventricle in front of us here. This is enlarged massively.
All the essential functions of the heart are now being carried out by the bypass machine. It keeps blood pumping around the body while the surgeons collapse Dieter's diseased organ and then cut it out piece by piece. Before they can install the mechanical heart, they need to replace old blood vessels with new plastic tubes and check for any potential leaks. The smallest hole, undiscovered at this stage, could prove disastrous. And finally, the moment of truth. Time to fit the new heart, join up all the connections, and put it to the test. Until now, Dieter has been kept alive by the bypass equipment around him. But what will happen when the machines are turned off? Only then will the surgeons know if the operation has worked.
Bisschen Volumen bitte geben und die Lunge mitbeatmen. Ja, Ende dann.
Relief. The reassuring sound of a mechanical heartbeat. The new organ is a miracle of medical engineering. Just like a human heart, it has four chambers and valves. Driven by compressed air, they're designed to send exactly the right amount of blood to the lungs, which is then saturated with oxygen and pumped around the body.
Now we are increasing the heart rate, you can hear that.
And they do this 100,000 times a day, 36 million times a year, like clockwork. At the moment, artificial hearts are still seen as a temporary solution because they need a constant supply of compressed air. But as the technology keeps developing, artificial hearts may become the normal choice for transplant patients.
We hope in the future that such a device is permanently to stay in the patient for at least 10, 15 years. That's our dream, and we hope to get that option.
For 15 years, Ingrid Kuntz has had severe cardiac problems. But 7 months ago, she had an artificial heart fitted.
I feel totally normal. I've completely recovered. I cycle every day on the cycle machine. I do physiotherapy. I do gymnastics. I do everything which I wasn't able to do before. I've become a totally normal person again. Except, of course, I have to carry the thing around with me day and night.
One day, the technology may become so good that healthy people will choose to have artificial hearts fitted, preferring them to their regular hearts. And not just hearts. The idea is that people will choose from a whole range of pick-and-mix bionic organs that'll make them fitter, stronger, superhuman.
You probably will have some people doing it, like people go in now for plastic surgery. They just augment their appearance according to standards of the day. They love doing it. One of the dreams of cyborgs is that you keep extending human capacity. You extend its lifespan, you continually augment to the point where you might say that we are meaningfully talking about intelligent design, because that's what we're doing. We're designing ourselves.
What we're going to do is deflate this expander.
Performance artist Stellark is doing what he can to bring this future a little closer. He has spent 2 months with a tissue expander in his arm, stretching the skin to make room for his artificial ear. Now it's done its job and is being removed.
This is the deflated tissue expander.
The surgeons have created a pocket ready to receive the frame of Stellark's new ear.
We're going to need a culture tube, okay?
Because of earlier problems with infection, they're having to work with skin that is not as thin or elastic as they would like. But they are confident the procedure will still work.
So, the framework there.
This is the moment Stellark has spent 9 years planning for. Time for his new ear to be implanted.
Come out now, I think. We don't want to push too hard because we don't want to break it. Double hook, please. And we'll take the suction tip. Now I'm just kind of sealing the wound here just temporarily.
All that's now needed to give the new ear some human-like definition is a little suction.
Inside. There. There we go. Here's the framework. Now you see we've applied suction.
It's good.
I'm pleasantly surprised. Is that cool or what? That's pretty neat.
Most people feel that technology should be an alien other rather than incorporated into the body itself. But because now most of our technology outperforms us both in precision, in speed, in power, perhaps it's time to modify the human body to better match the performance of its machines.
So if you get a focus in on the bars, you can see the bars going up and down as I speak, which shows that the microphone is still picking up sound and the ear is still functionally working. I'm going to count one.
But the real holy grail of cybernetics is to go beyond individual body parts and use technology to interface with our minds. And fantastic as this may seem, it is now beginning to happen. Is it possible to rewire the human mind? Could electronic implants take over the command system of the brain? This may sound like a futuristic fantasy, but it's already starting to happen. 4 years ago, Brandon Ingram was thrown out of a car in a gang-related attack. He broke his back, and ever since he's been paralyzed. His brain can't send motor signals down the spinal cord to his legs. But Brandon now has an experimental implant in his back, an oscillating field stimulator. It uses negatively charged current to promote nerve growth within the spinal cord and restore key connections between brain and legs. The implant was put into Brandon's back by Scott Shapiro, a surgeon at Indiana University Med School.
What we do is take this stimulator and we slide it right next to the spine, and then we take the electrodes and we'll suture them right here, one injury segment below an injury, and then we would suture another group of electrodes, a segment above the level of an injury. And the polarity, this would be negative for 15 minutes, and the negative pole strongly attracts nerve growth and stimulates nerve growth. And by stimulating and attracting this growth, we're trying to get growth both directions through the injury segment, trying to improve neurologic recovery.
On a good day, the most movement I can get is wiggling my toes, you know, because I'm not able to wiggle all my toes. I can wiggle my big toe back and forth, or I could bring my leg towards me. Anytime I just happen to just think about like trying to move it, it'll move. I mean, it's wonderful.
Since his paralysis, Brandon has turned away from gang life and found religion. He is convinced that sooner or later he will walk again.
I'm determined. That faith is so strong. It's been there with me from day one. I have no doubt in my mind. There's no stopping until I do conquer.
That young man has devoted his life to trying to recover more, and has turned his life around and has gone back to school, and is certainly somebody we're very proud of in all facets.
The day when paralysis can be reversed and normal motor function restored to someone like Brandon is still a long way off. It is early days for the implant technology, and the long-term effects on the spinal cord are not yet clear. But there are other ways to move a wheelchair that bypass the nervous system and the spinal cord altogether. Thomas Schreyer is moving through virtual reality by thought alone. He is paralyzed from the neck down, the result of a freak holiday accident.
I ran to the sea and jumped over the waves. And one of these waves pushed my feet up, and I crashed with my head on the bottom of the sea.
Since the accident, Thomas has been unable to move his arms or legs. But thanks to a new European research project, he is learning to maneuver his way down a street, albeit a virtual street. The cap he is wearing is packed with sensors, which pick up electrical signals from the motor section of his brain and send them to a computer. When Thomas thinks about moving, the computer software translates the thought into a command. The harder he thinks, the stronger the signal becomes. When it's strong enough for the line to cross the red mark, Thomas moves down the street.
Hello.
And whenever he meets a virtual girl, he thinks himself to a stop.
It was good to meet you.
Has a virtual chat before moving on again.
When I first suggested this idea of moving things by thought, and I wrote this in the proposal, people said, cut this out because this is crazy. People are going to think you're mad. It's never going to work.
Bye.
So it was very pleasing that the original so-called crazy idea actually works out.
It was good to meet you.
Moving in a virtual world is just the beginning. Researchers are confident that sooner or later, the same system will be used to propel Thomas's wheelchair down real streets.
Nice to meet you.
And give him back some of the freedom he has lost since the accident.
Bye.
But if a computer can translate human thoughts into actions, where might this technology lead? A young man in Atlanta, Georgia, is trying to find out. 5 years ago, Eric Ramsey had a near-fatal car crash. Ever since, he's been unable to walk or talk.
He's 100% paralyzed. The only movement he has that's voluntary and controlled is in his eyelids. And that gets tiresome after a while because his tear ducts are dried up. So everything else is either a spasm or a muscle tensioning or something like that. He has no way of talking or moving his arms or his legs at all.
Eric's paralysis was caused not by the car crash, but by a massive brain hemorrhage he suffered later in surgery.
They tried to wake him up the next morning. They couldn't. And finally, they did a CAT scan, and it showed that he had a blood clot in the pons area of the brain. And at that point, they waited about another 24 hours before they finally decided that he had locked-in syndrome.
Locked-in syndrome is the medical term for people who are profoundly paralyzed but remain as alert and intelligent as ever. They are ideal candidates for a groundbreaking new project. Eric has had a tiny electrode implanted directly into the speech center of his brain. The electronics for the implant sit on top of his skull, just underneath the scalp.
We put the implant in to help him to speak. We don't expect him to speak fully, but we expect that he will have some useful speech. And so we're trying to get him to escape from this locked-in condition that he's in.
The thought processes involved in speech are far more complex than those required to move a wheelchair. But Eric's implant allows the computer to register very subtle electrical signals and isolate single specific thoughts.
I.
The computer plays a phoneme, I, one of the simplest sounds in the English language. And then Eric has to repeat it in his head. concentrating on this one phoneme. If he is able to focus his mind clearly enough, the computer should be able to decipher exactly what he's thinking.
Well done, Eric. When you're ready for the next one, let us know.
Success.
Ooh, ooh.
Phoneme by phoneme, Eric's brain is willing the computer to talk for him.
Good, well done, Eric. We've already analyzed that he can detect 32 out of 39 phonemes. Now, if they can be pieced together, you can make a lot of words out of 32 phonemes. So you can probably get a useful vocabulary from it. I'm not saying he'll be able to speak normally, but it should allow him to communicate on a day-to-day basis.
This is an historic moment, the beginning of telepathic communication between man and machine. The first hint of a future in which humans and computers are as one.
Science fiction has always been thinking about what would happen if machines could read human minds. This is the moment which you would see either as the end of humanity, as some people do, or else you see this as the moment of transformation in an ecstatic way.
It's the ultimate cyborg fantasy. We become the machine. One day, it is said, man and machine will merge. We will become as one. Futurologists call this moment the singularity. And when it happens, they believe our species will change forever. We'll be able to reprogram the human brain with nanorobots targeting individual neurons, rewiring them, altering our biology. But the ultimate dream is that come singularity, we will be able to do away with our brain altogether and upload its contents directly into a computer.
Uploading is where you take a particular human brain, slice it up into very thin slices and scan each slice. So you get the three-dimensional map that you construct from this that is accurate down to the level of individual neurons and synapses, all the connections between the neurons. If you have a sufficiently powerful computer, and if you know what each type of neuron does, then you could emulate this whole computation that normally takes place in your organic brain in a computer. This is sort of the ultimate cyborg technology, where you have no more biological parts, but you could still continue to exist in a machine incarnation.
The concept of being able to take a print of you, your personality, your memories, your feelings, and somehow copy it, like all our favorite music tracks, onto a computer and keep it going for 1,000 years and put it into virtual realities. It's all kind of sexy and fun, and it's the conquest of death.
An uploaded brain will never age or decay. It'll be immortal. It'll also think in a completely different way.
If you run an upload on a computer that's 1,000 times as fast, it would start to think 1,000 times faster than the original human did. The external world would appear to such an upload as if it were slowed down by a factor of 1,000. So in 3 seconds, roughly the time it takes for a glass you throw into the air to fall down and hit the floor, the upload would be able to undergo the experiences we would have in 1 hour. So it could read a chapter in a book while it suddenly, very slowly, the glass coming up, and then make a telephone call before the glass hit the floor. If you have an even faster computer, the effect would be more extreme. If you speed it up another 1,000 times, then you have an upload that thinks 1,000,000 times faster than a human being.
Is this really our future? Super fast silicon mind seeing the world in super slow motion? Or is the whole idea of singularity just a far-fetched cyborg fantasy?
I don't know whether downloading of humans into computers will actually work. There needs to always be a voice that says it's an interesting possibility, but the practical gap is so enormous, we might not get there.
this tipping point, this moment when machines and humans finally combine, is nearly always just about 10 or 15 years in the future. At the moment, it's 2015, 2030, something like that, that scientists predict. But I suspect in 2015, it will be 2040.
In the field of cybernetics, imagination always runs ahead of reality. While people may dream about a future merger of man and machine, there are enormous obstacles to overcome.
It's interesting. Something's leaking.
For now, getting even simple devices to work within the human body is still fraught with problems.
It's quite sore at that point, too.
Performance artist Stellark has become a cyborg. His team of plastic surgeons has succeeded in fitting an artificial ear onto his left forearm.
Here we go. Here's the framework. Is that cool or what?
Now the operation is over, and the effects of the anesthetic are wearing off.
Hey, Stellark. How you doing?
Fine, thank you.
Everything went great.
Excellent.
We were able to get an ear on your arm.
Excellent. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Generally, everyone was upbeat after the operation. It was about 2.5 hours in length, and we had succeeded in surgically constructing a relief of an ear on this arm, and it looked really good.
There's your ear.
Oh, beauty.
Huh?
Yep. It's quite good, actually.
Yep.
Huh?
Excellent.
Good definition.
Yep.
Much better than any of us truly anticipated, to be honest.
Yep.
Look at the shadow there.
No, that's
very
right.
Dramatic.
It's much more...
Very dramatic.
Yep.
I can tell you it's the best looking ear on an arm that anyone has in the world.
Exactly.
I'll tell you that right now.
This was a huge step to not only construct the ear, but have an implanted microphone. In principle, we could have done a performance there and then. Connecting my ear wirelessly to the internet. That was all possible there and then.
2 weeks after the operation, Stellark is back home in Melbourne. But there's a problem.
That's interesting. Something's leaking. There's some seepage. You can just unwrap it and see what's up. It's quite sore at that point, too.
Stellark's arm has been irritating him for a few days, and now it's clear why. The area around the ear scaffold is badly infected.
Somehow the skin is not sticking to the scaffold. So at the moment it's more like a formless lump on my arm rather than any discernible ear shape.
The root of the infection is the catheter tube, which connected the microphone in the ear to a transmitter on his arm.
Okay, well, that's the exit point.
Having something exiting the skin was always going to be problematic. We were a bit unfortunate that the infection occurred sooner than later, but that's how it all happened.
The next day, Stellark is in ER at Melbourne Hospital.
Yes, I've just found out that we may have to not only remove the microphone, but the MedPor implant might have to come out as well. This arm has become so badly infected around the scaffold looks like I'm having to go into another operation this evening, in fact.
Stellark did go back into surgery, and as feared, had the microphone removed. Eventually, he lost the entire ear scaffold.
In any sort of artistic project, I think what's interesting is this slippage between what's intended and what actually happens. It wasn't surprising so much as it was irritating and disappointing.
For 9 years, Stellick has worked on this project, trying to realize his dream of a third ear. Although it has ended in failure, doctors can learn useful lessons about tissue regeneration and the pitfalls of developing artificial organs.
Just very little definition at all now.
Stellark has played his part in advancing the frontiers of cybernetics.
The idea of failing is not a totally negative thing. In fact, it can be turned around and seen in a very positive light.
Since the earliest days of the cyborg age, enthusiasm for change has always gone hand in hand with fear. As we become more machine-like, we worry that we become less human. In science fiction, cyborgs have almost always been seen as a threat to our species. But in reality, people with bionic implants are no less human. Quite the opposite. In every case, technology is helping them improve the quality of their lives, helping them become more human.
You can.
I don't think we should be frightened of cyborgs any more than we should be frightened of hip replacements or hearing aids. Cyborgs will be very useful and very helpful. They won't be gods. They won't be monsters.